Hi everyone, welcome to today's webinar hosted by Mindtree, featuring Mindtree's Salesforce practice, Magnet 360, and Salesforce on Retail Experience Must-Haves 2020 edition. I'm your host, Sarah Jeckman. Before we begin the presentation, I have a few housekeeping notes for you. You are currently in listen-only mode. If you experience any technical difficulties during the webinar, click on Help or send us a chat in the webinar console. This is an interactive session, so feel free to type your questions into the question box on your console. We'll do our best to answer as many questions as we can at the end of the session. I'd also like to mention that today's presentation will be recorded and available for future playback. We'll also be conducting a few polls during the webinar and would love your participation. All polls are anonymous, and you may see the results pop up in our future marketing initiatives. And lastly, we'd love to hear from you on social, so feel free to tweet us at Mindtree_LTD or use the hashtag CXWithMindtree. And now a quick overview of our program today. We've partnered together with Salesforce to look at the latest shopper research to see how e-commerce and digital retail trends have shifted since the beginning of 2020 and point out some key practices to implement as customer experiences are changing. When the stay-at-home order hit and retail stores closed their doors, our retail and customer experience experts put their heads together to demonstrate what a great customer experience looks like with the most recent digital retail experience, buy online, pick up curbside. And we'll finish out with a glimpse into the future based on the shopper report research and our experts' predictions for future trends. We've got a great program lined up for you today. And to start, I'd like to introduce you to our experts. Allison has over 11 years of e-commerce, QA, and content strategy experience. She's a technical expert with a background in retail business and client services, which helps her projects go far beyond just implementation, providing a complete solution for the customer. Joining us from Salesforce, we have Michelle Grant. Michelle is a seasoned researcher who helps organizations build the future of their business and is a globally recognized expert in the retail industry. At Salesforce, she blends data and analysis to create thought-provoking content that helps companies understand how new technologies will impact the future of their business globally. And Stephanie Rivard has over 8 years of experience in digital marketing with focuses in marketing automation and social media. She works closely with stakeholders to solution and map the technology to business and marketing objectives, optimizing tools such as Salesforce Marketing Cloud and Pardot across multiple industries like retail, healthcare, education, manufacturing, and financial services. And now I'd like to turn it over to Michelle.
Great, thank you for that lovely introduction. As a reminder, Salesforce is a publicly traded company. Customers should make buying decisions only on the products commercially available. We understand that it is a difficult time for everyone, so we really appreciate that you've taken the time to spend with us today, so thank you very much. And now I'll dive into our data and trends. So the World Health Organization declared COVID-19 a pandemic in mid-March. In response, states began shelter-in-place initiatives the same time. With stores closed, people turned to e-commerce for purchases. So this slide shows data from Salesforce's Commerce Cloud platform. According to our data, digital sales grew by 65% in the US from January to May 2020, compared to the same time period last year. And the chart breaks down the digital sales growth by month, both for 2019 and 2020. The 2019 figures are in light blue and give context to how large the spikes in digital sales are for 2020, which is in dark blue. So April was the first full month that everyone had to shelter in place, and digital sales were up 100% compared to April of 2019. And while the shelter in place order certainly helped drive digital sales, it's important to note that the stimulus checks and the federal pandemic unemployment compensation program were both launched in April. But what's interesting is that digital sales growth was even higher in May compared to April at over 120%. So even though some states started opening up in May, people continued to shop online. And many, you know, people have embraced digital shopping, especially with in-store pickup. Another reason for the continued growth is the fact that stores still have limits as to how many people they can allow in. So digital shopping is becoming more convenient and people are embracing it, even when stores are opening to a certain degree. Salesforce has also been conducting consumer surveys every 2 weeks to understand how consumer behaviors are changing in light of COVID-19. So this chart shows a percentage of respondents who say that they are doing more of these activities in the previous 2 weeks than they did prior to COVID-19. So these are the top five activities with higher than usual engagement. And it's not surprising that there's a digital element and with an emphasis on entertainment and online shopping. In fact, 46% of Americans say that they are shopping online more than they did prior to COVID-19. And that obviously we saw in the previous slide when it came to sales growth. And then on the other hand, in that little bubble there is from our survey respondents who said that they're shopping in store less, and that's 61% of Americans. So definitely a shift in behavior to online shopping and away from stores. And in our surveys, we also asked respondents about specific shopping activities that they're doing more of now. So with the rise of online shopping and food delivery, 35% of Americans are doing more contactless delivery, and over 30% are doing more buy online and pick up in store. When people do venture to the store, they're engaging in contactless shopping with about 30% of Americans using self-checkouts more, and 25% are using contactless payments more. So being very conscientious while in stores. Relatively new business models such as automated retail stores, subscription services, and social commerce are also seeing higher than usual engagement than prior to COVID. So now I'm going to hand it over to Allison and Stephanie to walk us through how retailers can improve the customer experience given these new shopper behaviors.
Thanks, Michelle. I think I personally engage with a lot of these that are showing up on the shopping activities. So this is the first time we're going to take a quick virtual poll with everybody. We just wanted to see what shopping activities you've most identified with, what's here from 2020. Great, we'll give everybody just a couple more seconds. All right, we'll wrap up the poll quickly. Nice. Contactless delivery is a big one. Buy online, pick up a curbside. I think myself as well. I've been ordering quite a bit of food lately and contactless delivery has been great. So we're going to talk specifically about buy online, pick up curbside and some of those other trends. So I'm going to hand it over to Steph to kick us off.
Thanks, Allison. So as we just heard from Michelle's insights from the retail shopper research, we're seeing that customer behavior, their expectations and the retail customer experience is shifting as new health and safety guidelines continue to emerge. We're going to walk through some of these fundamental practices that we as retailers should be addressing to get in front of these new experiences. Meet Joyce. She's headed out for a social distance camping trip and realizes last minute that she needs a new tent. Joyce is feeling like a lot of us right now, confused, uneasy, and overall just a bit anxious. Changes and uncertainties are happening across all industries right now, but an interesting shift's happening, especially in retail and e-commerce. We that who work in the industry have become our own end users, and we're all experiencing the same challenges when it comes to contactless shopping. There's not a best practice for how to overcome many of these new challenges yet. A study from the State of the Connected Shopper shows that 84% of customers say the experience a company provides is more important than their products and services, up from 80% in 2018. So what we do know is that without a seamless and well-planned customer experience across all touch points, there's greater potential to lose repeat business. So we have to get this right for our customers. We're going to walk through these new customer expectations and key areas of focus for putting a foundation together to build a strong customer experience. So where do we even start? Without a plan or a set of guidelines to look to, we're often left feeling overwhelmed and piecing together a customer experience based on the assumptions in the technology stack that we already have available. To create a great customer experience, let's boil it down to the fundamentals of what customers really want. We know what their key questions are, then we can leverage those answers as guideposts to create a strong experience.
So I think we all know as retailers and consultants that understanding the behavior behind a great customer experience is really just half the battle. We know we're often faced with making trade-offs between experience, the customer experience, and the technology that we have. Especially now, the bar seems higher than ever to meet bottom lines while our stores are still closed. And then differing state restrictions and store footprints add infinite variability to the amount of solutions that we're responsible for, making it very overwhelming. It's almost paralyzing to think, as Stephanie mentioned, where do we even start? So you're probably thinking to yourself, yeah, tell us something we don't know, right? But what I can tell you is that those retailers who can capitalize on this market, pivot quickly, and address those key customer concerns that we saw with Joyce earlier, stand to benefit even if they don't have an unlimited technology budget. So we're gonna take another quick poll, seeing as all of us can really relate to these challenges. Which one of these challenges have you and your team actually found most challenging to implement? And we're gonna wrap up the poll in about 3 seconds. Awesome, it's looking like figuring out in-store logistics and creating that omni-channel fulfillment is tough. So hopefully we will address some of those in the next couple of slides. So if we keep what our customers want in the forefront, now let's talk about how we adjust where and how we communicate with our customers in this new world of retail. So taking a look at the traditional conversion funnel, starting at awareness and brand generation through that shop flow into purchase and then fulfillment and delivery, let's compare the tactics and communication strategies from that old world and how we should be leveraging each section of the funnel to inform and build consumer confidence in this new world. So to generate awareness in the old world, we would leverage social or other channel marketing like email, affiliates to create brand generation and drum up brand interest. Maybe we do things like YouTube videos, a viral tweet thread, sweepstakes, or giveaways. Where in the new world, we should really be using social to target and distribute communication and information for that up-to-the-minute information. Use Instagram posts to maybe highlight store hours and state requirements, or even create a fun Instagram story to walk customers through the buy online, pick up at curbside experience, and make sure to leverage Google Maps or navigation apps for store-specific details. Now, if we move down the funnel into conversion, we typically leverage US best practices and focus on personalization throughout shop flow. This is to increase cart size or product exposure through our online channels, things like cross-sells and upsells, maybe videos on the product detail page. Where in the new world, the pickup process, we want to use the pickup process to set expectations and ease that concern for what the fulfillment or in-store experience might look like now. So whether that's adding information on the product page about how for pickup timing or even a global banner, we want to set those clear expectations before we even enter into the purchase flow. And then before COVID, the focus on purchase influence was driven by creating that frictionless customer experience and mobile-friendly options, things like address verification, maybe single-page checkout, or even Apple Pay. Where in the new world, we don't want to abandon those, but we should be adding instructions and information to instill that confidence and then really lay out what to expect for the new shopping experience. Things like asking for customer pickup detail information, self-help links, or a generic message that informs customers more details will be emailed to them. And then one of the areas with the most consistent customer experience in the old world was fulfillment. Before COVID, we knew exactly what to expect when we walked into a store, maybe when we stood in a returns line, or even made a digital purchase. In the old world, we would typically distribute the typical communications like store receipts, order confirmation, and shipment confirmation emails. Where in the new world, this is probably the largest shift of the focus area. So if we were to compare the size of this fulfillment in the funnel, the orange section in fulfillment would be much larger now because we have so many more steps from fulfillment. So in this case, over communication throughout each fulfillment step, whether it's the confirmation to picking up the order and then the multiple steps for ready for pickup, can definitely ease concern. Now, as Michelle mentioned, digital sales have more than doubled. So we shouldn't abandon any of the tactics that we have in the old world and our areas before COVID, but identifying some of those major holes specifically in the purchase and fulfillment flow can really help shape a brand's immediate digital roadmap to help that customer experience.
Let's go back to Joyce and take a look at how we can shape a great customer experience for her by adjusting her interactions to answer key questions throughout her purchase and pickup flow. For this experience and the remainder of the discussion, we're going to focus on the most common and pertinent social distance shopping experience, buy online, pick up at curbside. Here we start at the top of the funnel, leveraging channel marketing. By sending Joyce a targeted social post that's geolocated to her state, we're enticing and informing her that she can get her items.
And then moving into the shop flow and the purchase experience, by adding messaging and pickup information to the product page, we're adding confidence that we do in fact have what she wants. And then by allowing Joyce to set a pickup time, we're empowering her that she can get her tent and get it fast.
And finally, we move to fulfillment. By providing detailed instructions in her ready for pickup email, we're setting expectations on how she can prepare at home. By providing instructional messaging and SMS flows, we're instilling confidence on what she needs to do once she gets there. And finally, by closing the loop and asking for feedback, we're showing that we care about her experience and value her business. So let's dive into some prescriptive features and tactics that you can easily implement with Salesforce, B2C Commerce, Marketing Cloud, and Service Cloud to achieve the optimal customer experience across major interaction points in the customer journey. We're going to focus on Salesforce products, but regardless of the technology, these are some of the foundational elements that are necessary for creating a strong journey to support buy online, pick up at curbside. So the first step in the customer journey begins well before a customer even lands on the website. Taken from the Connected Shopper Report, in a time now when buy now buttons beckon wherever shoppers go online, other digital channels can't be ignored. WeChat, Instagram, Pinterest, and other emerging touchpoints for transactions now garner 9% of online purchases. Now, with the most recent introduction of Facebook Shop, consumers are looking to social channels for information, brand interaction, and purchase influence. Going back to Joyce, a couple days ago, she thought about purchasing a new tent and went online to explore. Since she wasn't comfortable entering the store and it was too late to ship it and get it on time, she wasn't comfortable and decided that her old tent had enough life in it to get her through this trip. Until a key touch point on social kicks off her buy online, pick up at curbside journey when she sees an Instagram ad. Joyce is a valued customer, and Northern Trail Outfitters understands the confusion of each state's regulation. They targeted her based on the data they had, and it came at the perfect moment. To ensure continuity in your customer experience from social and email to digital, you can leverage source codes from your social posts, triggering a mirrored experience with Salesforce B2C Commerce, either coordinating the homepage creative or simply carrying a geolocated banner. However, if you don't have the merchandising team to support over 51 unique experiences, make sure that your digital messaging remains consistent. Use that same language, creative, call to actions across all your marketing channels. Outside of the traditional marketing channels like social, email, and affiliates, another avenue that customers look to for store information are navigation apps like Google Maps. Updated store information is an absolute must these days. Google jumped on the recent retail challenges and now offers brands the ability to update their store feeds to include closure notifications, curbside pickup messaging, and special posts. This provides validation and confidence to customers that make online purchases a safe option.
All right, so it's looking like that targeted social post had worked. Joyce is entitled back to the Northern Trail Outfitters website and has found the tent that she wants. But a study from the State of the Connected Customer shows that nearly 2/3 of customers have used multiple devices to start and complete a transaction. So how many times, like, have you, just like Joyce, maybe seen a promotion or important information on an Instagram story or Facebook post, but by the time you get home, open your laptop, check out the brand website, you can't seem to find that corresponding information anywhere? Well, to alleviate this frustration, just as Stephanie mentioned, keep messaging consistent and accessible through the shop flow with a constant banner that mirrors your social messaging. And then to add an extra boost of confidence for this example, we leverage Salesforce Commerce Cloud's geolocation services that pre-select the closest store location to Joyce so that as she compares tents, she can immediately see if the item is available at her store. So as Joyce makes her way down the product page, be explicit and clear by adding the pickup method near the add to cart button. Include details like store address, store phone number, and the updated store hours. As stores begin to reopen, as we've all seen in the last couple of weeks, and you allow your customers different avenues to pick up their goods, it adds extra confidence to inform the customer of what pickup method, be it in-store, at curbside, or home delivery, even before they hit add to bag. So Joyce needs her tent before she heads out of town. So continue that confidence and eliminate doubt by stating an average timeframe for pickup orders right up front. Even a simple generic message resets expectations right on the product page. This allows the customer to make the decision on whether her timeline can be met rather than being disappointed as she makes her way through checkout. So if we think back to Joyce, we know that NTO has the tent that she wants. We know that she can pick up the tent curbside before she leaves for the weekend, so she's armed with the information she needs to confidently proceed right into checkout. So Joyce has about 50 other things on her mind, and at a time where shoppers are experiencing so many new processes and so much new information is coming our way, even outside of retail, setting expectations is critical. So keep continuity and reassurance from the product page by prominently displaying the delivery method before requesting any additional information at checkout. And then remember back to that funnel when we talked about old world tactics of frictionless checkout. We know now that we're asking for a lot more information from our customers. So whether you break up your pickup information across multiple pages or screens or expose them in a single step, as you'll see here over these next two slides, give customers the sense of purpose and direction by highlighting each of those steps and the reason behind each step. So in this case, we set the expectation by using directional phrases like first and next. So if we go back to Joyce, we know that she needs her tent ASAP. But other customers may not want to pick their item up as soon as possible. So give your customers the power to pick up their order at a time that works best for them. Not only does this empower the customer, but it also allows you and the stores to regulate your workload for your store associates. And again, Joyce will be picking up her tent on the way out of town, but there may be cases where customers placing the order isn't always the same person picking it up. So allow the customer to share the person's pickup information to alleviate any questions upon pickup. We also recommend giving the option for customers to enter details of their vehicle, especially in this case since it's buy online pickup at curbside. Things like make, model, color, or license plate state of the car to help those store associates quickly identify them and deliver the order. But make sure not to make these fields required since we know that some of the customers may be using public transit, ride shares, or car shares to pick up their order. So as Joyce is running around getting everything prepared, she won't be checking her email notifications regularly, but of course she'll have her phone under. According to IDC research, 79% of Americans have their phones on them at least 22 hours a day. So if you're not capitalizing on SMS, you need to. We've provided an optional opt-in here to receive order updates via SMS. So as she's running around getting everything packed, she won't miss an update about her order. And then an added bonus, we recommend adding the ability to sign up for SMS marketing communications right at the same time. Now, Joyce has chosen her pickup time, entered her car details, but she's still a little bit nervous about this, how this whole kind of curbside pickup thing is gonna work. I know I personally have been. So here we've added some general information about what to expect when she arrives in the store. And remember, we haven't even gotten to the payment step yet. So at this stage, it's not necessary to share every detail or even make it store specific here, but it is important to give a quick overview of what the pickup process is and what to expect, and then inform them that more details will be sent to them after placing their order. So now Joyce is feeling super confident and is getting more excited for a trip. So let's check out how Joyce will interact with NTO when she's placed her order.
As Joyce was placing her order, she read through all of the important information, but with some more on her mind, let's make sure that she can reference those again. Send a confirmation email and a text to reiterate the key messages. This email includes a banner at the top with important information regarding her curbside pickup. It also states her order details, which gives her the confidence that the items in her order will be correct and she'll be able to pick it up at her selected time. Taken from the state of the connected shopper, 66% of customers say that they often have to repeat or re-explain information to different representatives. 59% of customers say it generally feels like they're communicating with separate departments, not one company. And 68% would rather use self-service channels like knowledge bases or customer portals for simple questions or issues. Joyce notices that Northern Trail Outfitters has clearly called out their support information and has included some self-service links at the bottom of the email. she can head into her pickup experience knowing how to contact support and where to find information if she needs to. With a direct connection to the service team, any questions or concerns can be resolved in a timely and seamless manner. So if you're like me, preparing for a camping trip is a bit chaotic. I am definitely rushing around until the final minute, and Joyce maybe a little bit as well. So she felt comfort in knowing that she'd receive a text message when her order was ready so that she could pack up her car in the meantime and didn't have to watch for an email to come through. To enhance her experience, let's send a text when her order is being fulfilled with an estimated time for pickup as well. If Joyce's car Tetris skills are top notch, she might be able to leave home early and make it to the store to grab her tent as soon as it's available. Joyce receives a text and an email when her order is ready. The text includes the order number that she'll use to confirm her pickup, as well as the address so she can quickly jump into the navigation app. With limited character space, they refer her to the email that she received for the specific pickup instructions. So Joyce makes her way over to NTO, and the control of timing's really been put back in her hands. The message that she received asked her to reply here when she arrives. In the corresponding email, there's a lot more details that she can refer back to with any questions. In addition to the information in the SMS, it's important to provide store hours and a phone number. Reiterate the name and vehicle information of the person picking up the order, and most importantly, provide detailed instructions on what Joyce should do when she arrives at the store. Each store may have a different curbside process based on their footprint, so make sure the information is personalized. And remember, this experience goes beyond digital, so display clear and consistent signage curbside to make their arrival seamless. It's also helpful to include the order summary one more time so everything is available at their fingertips if needed. This email could also include a map of the store layout, calling out where the curbside pickup will be. Joyce responds to the text, and an associate brings out her order, is able to quickly spot her vehicle. He requests to see her order number, which she pulls up on her phone, and he hands over the tent. That's it, we're all done, right? Nope, nothing's more disappointing than leaving your favorite fast food drive-through and finding out that the fries you ordered aren't in the bag once you get home, right? Retailers are now tasked with making sure they don't cause those same frustrations. When fulfilling an order, attach a receipt and cross off the items as you place them into the bag. Once all items are packed, close the bag with a sticker and make it clear to the customer that all their items are in there. Finally, once her order is picked up, Joyce received an email from Northern Trail Outfitters confirming the completion of her pickup. Joyce picked up her own order, but the message provides peace of mind in case the order was accidentally given to the wrong person. In that scenario, she could call for service with the number provided in the email. Joyce also sees that she has the ability to provide feedback on her experience. Having never picked up her order curbside before, and with a tight deadline on top of it, she was really nervous when she first started this process, feeling like a lot of us right now. So with a continuous stream of information and reassurance, she felt at ease throughout her entire journey and wants to share that feedback. Requesting feedback is a great way for NTO to learn about their new processes through the lens of their customers, solve issues in a timely manner, and ultimately continue to learn and optimize while they navigate this new business model. Joyce also notices there's a thank you offer at the bottom of the email for a discount on her next purchase. She's already felt great about the experience she received and is excited to head back to NTO before her next camping trip in a few weeks.
So as we move towards the future and we face even more unknowns in the commerce space, it's helpful to implement these key foundations to create that strong customer experience that will keep your customers coming back. If we look back at Joyce's experience, there's two major themes that we've built upon: build confidence and over-communicate. Implementing these key tactics will allow you to create that strong foundation for the customer experience, whatever that next trend in retail brings. So from the beginning of the journey, capitalize on social channels and continue brand awareness and distribute that store information. Then keep messaging consistent, contextual, and at the forefront of all touch points. That's from mobile to shop flow to even in-store and at curbside signage. And then finally, continue communication, instill confidence, and request that feedback. We know customers' expectations are going to continue to change, so it's imperative to capture feedback to evolve and meet those customer expectations. So I'll throw you with one last stat from the Connected Shopper to close this one out that I'm sure we can all relate to. that 25% of shoppers have recently taken their business elsewhere as a direct result of poor in-store experience. So we know that budgets and timeline are tight, but those brands that can implement these foundational tactics by building confidence and continued communication stand not only to retain and delight their customer base, but bring in new ones as the word spreads about a great experience. So I'm going to send it back to Michelle now to provide us with some great insights about maybe what the future might hold and then how we as retailers can get ahead of those trends and new experiences.
Great. Thank you, Allison. So here we are again looking at data from the consumer surveys that Salesforce is running. But this one was fielded on May 14th and 15th. We asked consumers about their expectations for holiday spending during back to school and in winter compared to their spending in 2019. So back to school spending is in the light blue while winter holiday spending is in the dark blue. So for context, we also asked Americans about their perspectives on their financial situation to see how comfortable they would be in spending. At that time in May, 42% of Americans were quite or extremely uncertain about their financial situation for the next 6 months. So given the anxiety about finances, it's not a surprise that only 8% expect to spend more for the back-to-school season. What's interesting is that 46% of Americans selected not applicable or unsure. So in addition to the financial uncertainty at the time of the survey, and even now, we don't know what the back to school looks like. We don't know what the regulations will be, if people will go back to school in full numbers or have to alternate days. So I think that is playing into a lot of Americans' minds and what they would need to spend in order to go back to school is very up in the air. So now shifting over to the winter holidays, again, we asked people about their long-term financial expectations, and 52% of Americans are quite or extremely concerned about their finances beyond 6 months. So this is 10 percentage points higher than those worried about their short-term future. So again, in May, by this time we had the stimulus checks and we had the federal unemployment protection plan. And I think that gave a lot of people reassurances in the short term about their financial situation. But those plans obviously were short term. The unemployment insurance runs out in August. So looking beyond the next 6 months, a lot more people are worried about their financial situation. And we see this in their spending expectations for the winter holidays. Only 8% of Americans expect to spend more for the winter holidays compared to 2019, and 28% expect to spend less. So given these survey responses, it's likely that the retail sales will be down for the key seasons for the second half of 2020. We also asked respondents about their interest in shopping methods during the holidays. When compared to their behaviors in 2019. So we asked about five key shopping behaviors that we've listed out here in light blue. That's the percentage of Americans who expect to do more of that behavior. Dark blue is the percentage of Americans that expect to have the same level of behavior. And then the mauve is the amount of people who expect to do less of this activity when compared to their behavior in 2019. So when we asked Americans, how interested are you in shopping online? 49% said they were more interested in it compared to last year. 42% said that they had the same level of interest, and only 10% had a less interest in it. And then when we asked if they're going to buy online and pick up in store, 33% of Americans said that they would, that they had more interest in doing that than last year. 51% had about the same amount of interest, and only 16% had less interest. For those using an app to make a purchase, 31% were more interested in doing it this year, 49% had the same level of interest, and 19% had less interest. And then what's really interesting, right, is the shopping in store. So as of May, only 21% of people had more interest in doing that compared to 2019, 51% had the same level of interest, but almost a third at 28% of Americans had less interest in shopping in stores. So the big question right now is how much of the digital sales shift do we expect to remain for the rest of the year, especially as stores open? And it does seem, while it's difficult to predict, at least based on this survey, there's definitely going to remain, some of those sales will remain stickier. We'll see more people shopping online. We'll see more people using store pickup for those purchases. And that's just, you know, we just measured interest in those behaviors. There's still the uncertainty about when stores will be opened for at full capacity, which is obviously very key during the winter holiday season with doorbusters and all of these things that drive traffic. So it may not only be, you know, whether or not Americans are interested in shopping online, there may be still regulations that force them to do so. And so we're really confident that at least, you know, digital sales will be up, even if the overall retail environment will be down because of a pullback in spending. And as Allison and Stephanie explained, it's really important to reimagine the customer experience during this time. People are learning new behaviors, especially as new people start making purchases online for the first time. And we've seen the great adoption of curbside pickup as part of a contactless shopping behavior. And I predict that it'll stay through the rest of the year because of its convenience. And again, in the winter, you know, I'm based in Chicago, so not being able to get, not having to get out of my car in order to even pick up my order is a great service. So I do think that that will stay, and it's important right now to integrate that type of service and that customer experience flow so that when traffic is much heavier during the winter season, you'll be prepared. So now I'm going to kick it back over to Allison and Stephanie because they also have predictions for the future.
Great, thanks, Michelle. So I think that we just also saw from Michelle's insights, it's looking like our favorite term, BOPAC, or buy online, pick up curbside, isn't really going away anytime soon. But we do know that based on those insights, one of the biggest shifts is going to be the expectation of that shared physical and digital experience. So we know that as retailers begin to implement store fulfillment, as we're already seeing now, customers are going to be far less tolerant of that separation between in-store and online. And we're already aware of this trend happening. A stat taken from the State of the Connected Customer reported back in January 2020, before the COVID even happened, stated that 69% of customers expect connected experiences. So understanding that omnichannel is going to be the largest customer expectation, digital and marketing trends need to build, in this case, that we predict on three key foundations. So the first being centralizing customer data, right? Being able to consume all of the customer interaction points and then house them in a central location. The second is decentralized fulfillment. So being able to leverage stores as many fulfillment centers for all digital channels that goes beyond the regular just maybe brand website and if you're leveraging other marketplaces as well. And then the third is ensuring that your marketing communication strategy is consistent and contextual to the customer. Easier said than done, right? Seriously. But from some of the features and experiences that we predict will become the next big trends in digital retail. First one, returns and exchanges we think will be key. Customers will want to be able to, in this case, buy online and maybe return at curbside or maybe return at the digital locker. They'll also want to be able to buy in store and then start their returns online since they'll want to be spending less time in stores and that the store footprint or store restrictions will allow less people. And then second, retailers will need to get creative by allowing customers to physically engage with those products at home. A statistic that was taken from the State of the Connected Shopper shows that shoppers are almost 2.5 times more likely to make a first purchase at a physical store than they are online. So we need to figure out how retailers can capitalize on that tactile interaction that customers get in the store. So this may look something like Warby Parker's try before you buy, you purchase one, but you get three and then return the other two. Appointment shopping, maybe for smaller footprint stores that we're already starting to see now. And perhaps for higher end retailers, there may be digital clienteling or in-home personal shopping assistance for those stores that work on commission. And then once customers are allowed back in the store at higher capacity, the ability for curbside pickup may not even be logistically feasible. So either you don't have the parking lot space or you only have one associate working in your store. So my prediction, or our prediction, is the next wave is going to be for contactless fulfillment, adopting something like the Amazon locker approach. Malls and retailers, or maybe a central location in a town or a city, may share these centralized lockers where customers can access their merchandise with either a scan of a code, a swipe of a phone, that they can either pick up their merchandise or they can return it.
So how can we expect marketing to change as well? So consumers are spending all this extra time at home really glued to their phones, and that tells us that mobile isn't going anywhere. Salesforce found that SMS text messages have a 98% open rate. Quite the difference than we're used to seeing with emails, right? Of course, the content and messaging serves a different purpose, so they'll continue to provide value. However, it's critical to meet the consumer where they are. Use SMS messages to provide transactional content like Joyce received and share promotions in the future. Incorporate your mobile app into Marketing Cloud functionality to target customers with a push message at the right point in their journey. As Michelle mentioned, 43% of respondents are using social media more now than they did before that pandemic. Take advantage of a shopper's impulse when they see a great product and allow them to shop directly from their social apps. And finally, with so many uncertainties as of late, shoppers are supporting the brands they love and trust. If you don't have a loyalty program yet, now is the time to get one. According to Salesforce Connected Shoppers report, nearly 8 in 10 consumers are more likely to buy from brands with a loyalty program. Drive revenue by rewarding your customers for shopping with you, share exclusive merchandise, and especially now in times where some of our customers may be more nervous to enter the store, give access to private shopping events that have a smaller count of customers coming in. So as we look towards the future, let's take another final poll on which of these trends you're most looking forward to implementing.
All right, well, we're going to wrap up the poll. I'm really interested in this one. Oh, nice. So looks like try before you buy at about 44%, and then shop in-store by appointment is right behind it in 33%. That's super exciting. I think it's always nerve-wracking to look into the future, but definitely exciting, some of these new retail trends for sure. So just a big thanks for joining us today. We had a lot of fun putting this content together. We really hope that you did find some of these tactics helpful to determine your feature and then customer experience roadmap. So we're gonna kick it over to Q&A if anybody has any specific questions about what we talked about, and looking forward to your questions.
Thanks, Allison. Now I'd like to invite our speakers to come back on video for Q&A. And I do see a couple of questions have come in, but I just wanna remind everyone to go ahead and type your questions into the question box located on your console. Any questions we don't get to will be answered via email after the event. Okay, so our first question comes from Rachel. With such a wide variety of store footprints like strip malls and enclosed malls, et cetera, how can we standardize some content yet make it personalized?
I can start with that one. So from a marketing perspective, if we think about Marketing Cloud, it's really important to have some standard email templates ready to go that can be very flexible to house different types of content. As we looked at Joyce's experience, there were several different emails she received throughout that whole process, but one template that we were able to use multiple times. It's also really important to take advantage of the dynamic content or AMP script functionalities. You can even leverage this across channels as well so that you can create one version, multiple pieces of data in there based on each different subscriber's data.
Okay, great, thanks. Our next question comes from Angela. I'm curious as to what the return trends are. My personal prediction is lower, but what are retailers seeing and has that helped revenue?
I can take this one or start off. We haven't really seen any data as far as the percentage of returns that are happening, or at least I haven't personally, but we do know that returns are up in general because so much of the purchasing has happened online. And online purchases have a higher return rate in general than purchases made in store. So that's actually causing a bit of a problem for retailers because One, they're already operating with fewer people due to social distancing guidelines in the warehouses and distribution centers, as well as in stores. So it's taking them longer to process the returns. And then for safety reasons, many of the products are being quarantined to allow the virus to die off of them. So that is also causing an issue for them to be able to resell some of that product after the 3 days is usually what's taking a great deal. So this is sort of like the first rush was to get your digital capabilities up and running to process the transactions. Many retailers extended their return windows to give people confidence in being able to return to store. And now that the stores are open and people have made a lot of purchases online, in general, the absolute number of items is that's being returned is very high, and retailers are now working through that process in order to basically process all these returns with the limited capacity that they have.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be interesting to see how returns pan out. I know I was just talking to somebody who had an experience where they tried to return something to Target, and they had purchased in store and tried to return it online, and they had just said, just keep it, we'll write it off. So we're seeing either more of those where some of the larger retailers who don't have that mixed fulfillment capacity, either donating or just kind of diming them out. We also might see kind of more pop-up shops or secondary consignment shops. I don't know, it's going to be really interesting, the time for specifically in apparel, for sure.
Right.
It'll be exciting.
Great. Our next question comes from Ashish. What do you expect will need to change about in-store shopping experiences too?
Michelle, you want to take this one or do you want me to start? You can go ahead.
Yeah, I can start. I think the broad framework when it's in-store shopping is you need to think about how safe are my employees, how safe are my products, and how safe are the physical infrastructure, right? So if you look at everything as it needs to be through the lens of safety and cleanliness. So, you're going to see a lot more, like I said, even if you're in a fitting room, if the fitting room is even open, a lot of the products that or the products that you've tried on will again be quarantined before they put it back out on the floor. Everyone obviously is wearing masks. You have the social distancing markers, the plexiglass around the cashiers, testing your employees as they come in to make sure that they don't have a temperature and that they say that they're feeling fine. So everything now has to be viewed through a lens of cleanliness and hygiene and safety, and then that being communicated to the consumer to have the confidence to go in store. And I know Allison has greater detail on what she's seeing.
Yeah, great. I know Michelle and I were actually chatting about this the other day from a digital side of things. So we know the expectation is whether that's outlining kind of 6 feet apart on the stores, having more additional signage, just like what Stephanie talked about too. But Michelle and I are kind of talking back and forth about what the digital perspective is going to be. And we're thinking that's going to be more like QR codes, the ability to be able to scan, and whether that's see a menu on your phone by standing outside instead of holding one, or being able to quickly pull up from a contactless payment. We know that Walmart's in the process of trying to actually get rid of all of their checkout associates. So whether that's what you see as having a QR code or a scanner that you would actually use as your wallet, I think that we're definitely going to see that the safety and cleanliness, I think from a digital standpoint, is really going to flow into what that contactless payment looks like when you're in the store. So that cashless and even not even having a card exchange with associates. So I think it's going to be a big trend on the POS side too.
All right, thanks. This next question comes from Tom. If we've already implemented buy online, pick up at curbside using these suggestions, what else can we do to create an even better customer experience?
I can take this one. I think what we talked about earlier was just the foundations, right, to get everything into place. But there's definitely plenty of other areas that you can target, whether that's using, if you have Marketing Cloud, using DMP to pull offline data and information and have larger segments of customers, targeting larger segments of customers to bring in new. But also, if you're already implementing buy online, pick up curbside or buy online, pick up in store, Again, we talked about that decentralization of inventory, which is a lot easier said than done. So being able to have that kind of shop my store experience right on the product listing page. So we know that Joyce wanted a very specific item, but if somebody is looking for shopping for the holidays, they may be shopping for a large number of people. So there may be multiple categories that they're searching across. So being able to leverage that shop my store on the product listing page to be able to filter down quickly and really create that great customer experience even higher up in the funnel. And then I think if we really get geeky on the technology side of things too, on the fulfillment side, either leveraging something like beacons or having like RFID chips that are in the merchandise itself. So similar to how we see in some of our delivery apps, where we see the merchandise or we see the person who's coming to our house in their car. On the opposite, we would actually see where the merchandise is at a given time, whether that be in an app or being able to ping, you know, kind of where's my order. So as we start to see whether it gets delivered out to the car or whether it's to a locker, from a digital standpoint and a customer experience, the customer can actually see physically where their merchandise is and when they can expect it. So on two sides of the coin there.
And I'd add in there too, as we talked about, the number is very alarming as to the number of people that feel like they're talking to different departments or not even one company. And as you think about, as we talked about the BOPAC process, but as Allison mentioned, some other things to look at for the future is just making sure that no matter what you're implementing, no matter what channels, no matter what departments internally that you're working with, it's to make sure that that data is connected to keep that single line of communication across.
All right, great. We have another question from Kai. I've noticed an increase across the board with retailers saying their customer service contact times are very delayed. What would you recommend retailers do to combat this problem?
Let's start with this one. So yes, we've definitely all noticed this one. I think making sure that you have multiple options for your customers to reach service. So whether that be phone or chat or cases, there can be multiple ways and the service team will be able to manage these differently to take advantage of the different platforms that they're working with. Another great way is with the connection of Social Studio to Service Cloud, you can have posts that are automatically routed to the service team and take advantage of some pre-canned messages that could go out there as well. So you're catching them from different channels, but you're prepared with the types of concerns they may have and already have some of those messages pre-written out.
Yeah, I think
Okay, I was just going to add to that, like obviously at Salesforce, we've seen a lot of our chatbot usage has just increased. So automating messages around the real problem areas is probably the best way to handle the unexpected spike in customer service inquiries.
Yeah, Allison. Absolutely. I think a couple of things. One, we talked about on what happened. So that's the reactive approach. So I think that that's really important, but also giving a proactive approach too. So whether that's setting self-help links or right on the product or like having a banner on the storefront or being able to leverage specific information and locations to go to, be it on social. So on both sides, right, from a proactive perspective, give customers the ability to really find the answers themselves. If it's about what's my return window or how is this in-store process going to work. And then on the reactive side, absolutely echoing what the other two ladies have just said about using Marketing Cloud and redirecting from either cases and chatbots to say, or giving customers a direct location to go to say, if you have a question about returns, then it'll go into a much shorter queue. So instead of having thousands of people on the same queue to sort them out, use the technology from the Salesforce side of things to redirect them so that they're smaller queues that are associated to very specific issues and problems. That's a good question.
Nice. So actually this next question has come up from a few different people. I'm gonna read Brian's. Could shops have virtual shopping in store, maybe with virtual reality goggles? Would this be even better for continued shopping in store?
I'll take this one first. I think the long term, virtual reality has more application in a shopping setting. Right now, in the short term, there's just not enough headsets and the actual technical gear that you need at home to have scale to use it in a shopping experience. So it's coming together. There's a lot of integrations with payments and voice that is happening, with a virtual reality headset. It's just very nascent right now. So it's not something that I would expect to really take off in the short term, but there is definitely potential in the long term. What we're seeing is kind of almost like ad hoc workarounds to that experience. So there's virtual clienteling where the sales associate, particularly I think it was Gucci that came out with this, the sales associate in the store is taking you around with their device and showing you things on camera, virtual appointments where you're talking one-on-one with a stylist or in beauty about fashion and makeup, through a Zoom call or FaceTime. So there's these sort of hacks to give this virtual experience from a distance. The other thing that actually I'm more bullish on in the short term is augmented reality. So we've seen a lot of adoption of consumers using augmented reality. It's gotten very good with the latest cameras on the phones to give a really good experience, both mainly in homewares and home furnishings, but also in beauty and a little bit to like fashion is getting there. But so augmented reality is probably more of a short-term gain in being able to try things on before you buy them in a virtual sense. So this has been a lot of the beauty companies have cited that their lipstick try-ons, their lash extension try-ons, all of that has been boosted during the quarantine to help people kind of select things. And then oftentimes people will still want to talk to associates to get their advice and opinion. So it's kind of a one step of many in the sales process, but definitely AR and kind of just traditional video calling have really been a boon currently.
Okay, fantastic. I think we have time for one more question. Coming from Andrew, how do we as retailers get ahead of Amazon? If Amazon can guarantee next day delivery, how can we compete?
I can take this one first. I think there's a couple, that's a tough one, right? We do know that from some of the reports that we've looked at to create this deck, especially some of the connected customer, the connected state of the connected shopper, state of the connected customer, we saw that brands who buy with loyalty, right? We know that there are, I think, about 80% higher in terms of purchasing or continuing purchasing with a brand. So as Stephanie mentioned, loyalty is huge, right? Keeping that loyalty and those benefits. So whether that is, we just saw Walmart with Walmart Plus get on the Prime bandwagon. I'm not saying that everybody needs to adopt something that's like a Prime approach, but being able to give your customers that surprise and delight or having limited items that are specific just for those brand loyalists. So I think that's one thing to keep. We all know that a lot of people are gonna look to Amazon for their essentials or something that they need right now. But if it's with regards to purchasing specifically for themselves, or if it's a brand of apparel, using a loyalty is really big too. I think another one for using SEO, SEM and your affiliates, make sure that your Google feeds are updated, that they're up to date. Make sure that you're leveraging those long tail keywords. So if we know specifically in this case with Joyce, she was looking for that kind of Stormbreaker 2 tent. So using either long tail keywords for in-store pickup, same date pickup, that if customers are searching on Google or ahead, that you can kind of circumvent in some cases, or you can get ahead of that retarget in marketing as well. I think maybe Stephanie, you might have some perspective on using other marketing initiatives too.
Yeah, really, it's as much as you can connect your data and meet your customers where they are. We're finding, like I said, people are on their phones right now. So whether that's through the apps that you're already using, connecting that data in to hit them at the right time, or text messages like we talked a lot about, and social is so big right now. So as long as you can keep a great experience across those channels and find creative ways to stand out across your competition, I think that it's really going to be a deal breaker if you can really nail mobile and social.
All right, thanks, ladies. That's all the time we have for today. If you're interested in learning more about our commerce offerings, our team is ready to help. Please reach out to Diana Eveson at magnet360.com if you have any questions. I want to thank our speakers, Allison, Michelle, and Stephanie, and a special thanks to you, our audience, for spending the last hour with us. Please keep an eye on our social channels or our Mindtree events webpage for upcoming events. Lastly, we'd really appreciate it if you would take a short survey immediately following the session. A window will appear when this webinar ends. Thanks again. Have a great day, and we hope to see you at another event soon.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Yeah.
Bye.